All right, welcome back to the channel. You guys remember the eBay JK that we built on a budget? We built in the garage, actually in the front yard. Now we're here in front of the shop. We got a few more budget items we're gonna toss at this thing, starting with a winch. Ian is actually gonna put this on. If you guys are familiar with Harbor Freight, I mean, the Apex winch is pretty strong, man. I've been using it on quite a few rigs. For what it is, I think that bang for buck, you're not gonna beat it. Now, you do want something that you can count on. I would say there's a lot of cheap winches out there, even some of the other versions of the Harbor Freight winches that I'm not super fond of, but the Apex winch is a solid, solid winch. I've had really good luck with it. These Jeeps are heavy. Realistically, when it comes to a winch, you wanna have basically double the pulling power. If you have a 6,000 pound vehicle, you want a 12,000 pound winch if you're planning on actually using it when you need it. Ian is gonna bolt this guy up. I'm gonna let him take charge, show you what he does to get the bolts in, because he's gonna have a fun time getting up in there to get those bolts in this bumper. And then we got a few other things to do on this Jeep today.
All right, so the first thing we need to do is go ahead and get this thing bolted in. So I'm gonna have to go underneath here, get this thing bolted onto the bumper first. Now, it does come with like little bags and stuff, and then this one has the bolts in there to connect the winch to the bumper, and they are a 5/8. So I'm gonna go ahead and get underneath there, get them on, and then tighten them up a little bit. All right, so the first step to getting this winch on the bumper here is there's little holes on all four sides that we need to put the nuts into. Now, usually they're more common to be a square nut, but a normal nut should just be just fine if they fit in there and they don't wiggle around to tighten up. So just stuff them in there, then we should be good to go. Now, I think it might be common sense, but I'll just give you a fair warning right here so it doesn't happen to you. Right here, this lean's fine because the nuts aren't gonna come out, but make sure when you are moving the winch, you don't move it side to side here too much, or else those nuts will just fall out and then you'll end up losing them somewhere. So underneath the bumper, I got pretty decent, easy access here. Might be a little bit of a butt to go ahead and tighten them up with a nice little ratchet and socket combo. These packs come with a nice little lock washer combo here. We're gonna put on the bolts, and then we're just gonna go ahead and finger tighten them up now, and then go from there. All right, now she's all loosely bolted in. Not tight just yet, but nice and finger tightened to the best of my ability. Now we gotta look underneath the hood and see where we're gonna put the wires. So, all right, looks like we gotta wire it all the way up back here. I think I'm going underneath the grill, somehow wiring it up to here. Gonna take a lot of zip ties, but we'll get there.
All right, now Ian almost just learned a valuable lesson. A lot of winch bumpers, you have to put your fair lead on first. You have to put your bolt in from this side because there's not enough room for the nut. Fortunately, there's enough room here for this to clear. So we can go ahead and get the fair lead on next. The next thing I would do though is cut the zip tie that holds the winch line on, push that through, and then bolt your fair lead on, because it's a lot easier to have the front of your winch hook or whatever out here when you're bolting that on.
So right here, these bolts are gonna be a 3/4. So now we're gonna need to do is there's gonna be a little lock washer that they're gonna give you, and then just put the lock washer on and then the nut on from the back. And then right here, just put in a nice little deep hole socket with a ratchet. Ratchet it up with a box end wrench holding on the back, and then you should be able to just tighten it up just fine.
Big hands and tiny crevices. Very difficult.
Booyah. Now that that's in there, we're gonna work on the wiring. First up is gonna be putting that ground in, and then it's gonna attach right here on this little nut, right behind that nut. When we're attaching it, make sure that you're not pointing it down towards the bumper, or else it's gonna pinch that wire and possibly malfunction. And the last thing you want is a ground to malfunction. So we're gonna keep this pointing up and away from the bumper, so we make sure that it's not gonna pinch. Once you're putting this ground in right here, make sure that this box ground right here, I don't know if you can see it, it's a tiny little wire right there. It's a tiny little wire, goes from the ground area all the way up into the box right here. It's connected to the positive wire that it came with, but make sure that that stays in there, so don't take that out. And to go ahead and tighten up that nut, that's gonna be a half inch, pointing away from the bumper, of course, like I said, and then we'll go from there. All right, now that we got these wires here, we're gonna take these, feed them underneath the grill, and I believe the best spot here is we're gonna have to connect it here, run up the side, away from everything right here, and connect ground positive. Good rule of thumb, when you are working with anything battery related, just take off your positive so you don't even have to worry about it. Make sure it's not touching anything. And then just pull it up, make sure it's disconnected, not touching, and then you should be safe from any electrical disasters.
Now while Ian's wiring up the power, I'm gonna go ahead and hook up the hook, which is pretty simple. You just have a cotter pin here with a post. I like to have the cotter pin on the top side. You can put it on either, but a lot of times if you're going to grab this hook and you're trying to pinch this up, last thing you need is this thing down here poking you. So I like to have the cotter pin up high where I can see it and then know that it won't poke me. Also, while we're at it, I'm going to show you proper cotter pin etiquette. A lot of people will try to bend this one out and bend this one out, and that's not right. What you want to do is come up here and just go straight over the top. Once you have the proper cotter pin bend there, then you want to take your excess here and just cut that off. If you have cutters that can do it, I do not. Well, if you didn't have Chiwana stand cutters, you cut it right there. And that way, if you ever have to take it off, you just bend one back straight and you can slide it out. That's the way you really want a cotter pin to go.
So I got these fed through here and they're right next to each other. Make sure when you're feeding them through, they're underneath any type of body. So right here, when I was originally feeding them through, I was underneath this bar right here. Make sure it doesn't have any access to rocks being able to hit it, just for safety. I'm gonna go ahead and zip tie these two together so they don't like go all crazy cuckoo on me, and then I'll figure out where to actually attach them onto the Jeep so then they don't move around into anywhere they don't need to be. I'm gonna go ahead and connect the ground into the ground and then the hot onto the hot here, and then finish up the zip tying, put this back together, and then show you the winch working. All right, we got it all connected in, wired up, got the zip ties in, got just connector zip ties to them, and then they connect to a couple hoses here, keeping them away from anything bad like radiator fan or maybe the belt or anything like that. They just keep away from that, just stay tight up against here. This is loose right here, but it's not gonna go anywhere, I don't think. That's kind of snug. Now, it's time to tighten the bottom of the winch up because I hadn't tightened those up yet. Now the bumper is nice and tight. Not going anywhere, ready to rock.
All right, Ian says he's done. Let's see if he did it right. Power on, wireless on. Hey, it works. Hey, come on up, come on. Come on, turn it like you mean it. Come on, let's get out of the heat. Heat coming, that's good. Good. All right, so the next thing we gotta do is put a new top on here. Now I did have an eBay top, the best top that was on here originally that somebody put on like in 2009. Problem was is over 10 years later, all the windows were faded out. So I tried this really, really, really cheap eBay top, and we just had a hailstorm come through here in New Mexico, and look. This top's maybe about a year old. I still feel like Best Top is where it's at when it comes to tops, probably, but I'm gonna try one that was just a few bucks more. It's a different color as well because, you know, like I said, we're here in New Mexico, it gets hot, and so we're gonna try a little bit cooler top. So right here, you have two screws right here that go in there, and then there's two screws here. That part is pinched in the front when it folds over with that little ring there. Now it's really hard to get that in there unless you have the outside off. So what I like to do is pull all these screws out all the way down. You can pull this cover off, put the new cover on, set it in there, and then screw it back in. It's kind of a pain in the butt, but it works. That's usually the way I do it. Now I am gonna go ahead and get the new top over here and try and see if I can just slide it in. But if I can't, then that's how I gotta do it. You gotta pull all those screws out and then screw it back on. So the unfortunate side of these tops is that they're so cheap that you can't even buy a backup window. A used window costs more than the old top. I think I paid only like $200 for the whole top. I paid $300 for this top, so we'll see if it's any better. Fresh and brown. What else can you find that's fresh and brown? All right, let's see if we can feed it in from over here. I think it's working. Well, that was way better. The last time I've done one of these, I had to take all these screws out. Like I said, there's just a bajillion screws in here. And then you gotta fight getting them back in. If you just take the in-two screws out, we got enough open so that we could just slide it all the way through. That made it way better. Now, I'll tell you what, one nice thing too about these Bushwhacker fender flares is they're like a bench. They're a nice flat spot where I can store stuff. Remember that you're just screwing into plastic, so you don't want it to be very bad, very tight. This is a Sierra off-road top. I can tell you that the material feels a little better than the other stuff, but we'll see how much better it works. All right, so right here is a Velcro section. You just gotta Velcro that part in. So Ian can do that while I hold this up. That's gonna help a lot. Having it folded in keeps the tension off it. So you wanna really kinda get all these on before you get tension to everything. And ideally, you just work down from one side all the way to the other. All right, so I got Ian holding this up to keep tension off it. If you have it all the way over, it pulls out too far. This comes way out here. If you bring it back, then you got everything in your way. So you kind of just need two people to do this. But we will get it on. Alrighty, we can move to the back. And then you just repeat the same steps on these back four. So these ones got little flaps and you swing it around and then screw it into there. Just like that. All right, so now that we got all that done, Ian's gonna pick that up. That'll take tension off of here and we can snap the corners in. There we go. Now we can flip the front over, we'll latch it down. That gets it nice and tightish. All right, go ahead and latch those in. Forward as you do it. Snap these in on the sides. Also, ideally, you'd like to do this on a warm day because if it's cold, doing one of these tops really isn't fun. Okay. Then you got a nice little rain gutter. All right, so now we just gotta zip up the windows, and what's crazy about this is the cheapest rear zip-up window I could find was like $200 or something, $250, and that was used. I couldn't even find a new one. And it's like for $50 more, I got a brand new top that I think is even better than the one I had. Plus, it's a brown instead of black, so it shouldn't absorb as much sun, which might make it a little nicer down here in the desert. Cool. Put those in and we'll be good. Perfect. Tinted windows. Much nicer color. That should help a lot. That actually went really quick. The last time I did one of those was by myself, so having Ian here made a big difference. Now with the big thing, what you guys have probably been waiting for. If you remember when Shannon and I let Ian and Skyler drive, we went up to Hotel Rock. over in Blanding, Utah. One of the things that they had the problem with was the Jeep was overheating. It would put itself into limp mode because the transmission was getting too hot, so just pulling too hard. It actually has a transmission temp sensor that makes you stop and cool down. And I've been scratching my head on what would be the affordable way to get gears in this thing to actually help gear it down. And honestly, you could do what I've done in the past and gear the axles. The thing about that is gears really aren't very expensive, but usually when you do gears, you want to do lockers. And then you got to have a lot of tooling. The biggest thing about gears is having the tooling and the knowledge. So this toolbox I have right here is set up just for gears and axles and stuff. Like I have my pinion bearing puller, which is a tool you'll need. Pry bars, obviously. You're gonna need air hammers. You're gonna need clips. You're gonna need seal pullers and race drivers and calipers, micrometers, you know, dial indicators. You're gonna need a lot of things to do gears if you wanna be able to do them right. So even though gears are actually pretty affordable when you think about just buying gears and install kits, the tooling and the knowledge takes up the time and the budget. And we all know the only other way to get lower gears is through a transfer case. Unfortunately, aftermarket transfer cases are quite a bit of money. One thing I did find that was fairly reasonable is a Rubicon transfer case.
421. 241J.
There is a jump in transfer cases for the Jeep Rubicon that you want to make sure you have the right years. I think it's 2013, 2018, I think is where the jump is, depending on if you have a manual or an automatic. But this Rubicon T case I actually got for $1,200, what I feel is pretty reasonable for a 4-to-1 T case. That's going to give us a lot more low range. A factory Jeep has a 272-to-1 low range. The higher the numerical number, the lower the gears. So the output of the transmission is going to spin four times to one rotation here, which means you're going to get a lot more torque out of it. You're going to put a lot less stress on your transmission because it's not trying as hard to get this transfer case to move, which is in turn trying to get your axles to move and then get your tires to move. And from what I know of 4-to-1 T cases, all it's going to take is just a little bit of elbow grease, unbolting drive shafts, unbolt your old case, and bolt in the new case and put in some fluid. So let's see what it's going to take for us to do it on here.
All right, so we got the Jeep jacked up here. I just need to get underneath, and I just need to take apart a few things. I got the skid plate, and then I got some drive shafts to take off, and then we'll be good to go. As always, getting underneath the vehicle, safety first. Let's get to it. All right, for the skid plate here, I just got these bolts right here. So we got one, two, and then two on the back. Pull this off. Access this side of the drive shaft right here on the rear end. Pull that off, pull the front end, and then we should be good to go. Don't need to take the drive shaft completely off here.
Yeah.
And they're a little rusted in there. Love a crawler, but you can never get any leverage on one. Bolt one down, three more to go.
Right, plated skids. Been used a little bit. There we go.
All right, so all bolts are off now. Make sure you got these little, I don't know what you call them, little adapters or something. I don't know if I'm supposed to go front and rear drive shaft, but doubling up there, keeping them separate just in case. This is off, the rear drive shaft off right here. Now I just need to take this bad boy off.
All right, so I did the same thing to this drive shaft. Now we got to get the shift linkage off here. And the easiest way I found to do that is just take your pry bar and just pop that off like so. I'd say that's in bad shape because that just came right off. Not even thinking about it. Then you just got to unbolt these two bolts here. Six bolts in a circle around this transfer case where you can pull this T case off. On the old Cherokees and TJs, it was a 9/16 nut. I don't know what it is on this, because I honestly have never owned a JK that I pulled a T case out of. But it looks like it could still be a 9/16, which would be nice. All right, so one of the issues Ian's having here is getting to the nuts at the top of this transfer case. Now, normally, you have to drop the skid plate down to get to the transfer case, get it low enough to actually get in there. I'm going to try this tool. I got this off the Matco truck. It is 140 tooth, I think, quarter inch ratchet, but I can also rotate the head. I'm sure all your big name tool brands make this. This is not a cheap ratchet,
But if I don't have to drop the transfer case, drop all the skid plate stuff, and make everything come down just to do the get a couple of bolts, then to me, it's worth it.
All right. Oh, man. And then they made the top one tighter than snot. But if I can get that broke free, it will work. All right. There we go. It's working.
So if you don't want to have to drop your skid plate, which means you're going to have to drop your gas tank skid plate, then your crossmember skid plate, and your skid plate, then you may want to invest in one of these, because this thing was a lifesaver getting that those top two bolts out.
You should be able to get it down, just don't angle it forward. You're going to be bench pressing it. You want me to do it?
I mean, I'm strong.
Or we could use a jack.
You kind of scare me. You not trust me?
No, I'm just watching.
Oh, there's still stuff plugged into it.
You didn't unplug it?
No. Oh, jeez. Go back in. Okay.
You didn't unplug the hoses then?
No, I didn't. I didn't know I was supposed to unplug those.
There's going to be a breather hose and a little plug.
Yep. Got a little weighted blanket. A very heavy weighted blanket.
Roll on out.
It's my transfer case. Roll on out.
Transfer case chest. Oh, yeah. You're lucky that's new style transfer case, not an old style. The slip yoke could just dump transmission fluid all over your crotch doing that.
How am I getting up?
Oh, you want help?
Yeah, can I have some help?
You stuck?
Yeah, just a little bit.
All right. I don't know. I'm like, oh, I can't do it. Oh, no, just kidding. Here is the transfer case that was in there. So this is a 241J 272:1, meaning it's got 272:1 low range. So if I were to spin this 2.72 times in low range, that's one rotation out here in low range. This one is a 241J 4:1. This one's out a Rubicon. So in low range, if I were to spin this output four times, it spins this one once. So that's going to put a lot less stress on the transmission. It can spin a lot easier because all the gearing is in here and it's not trying to work the gearing down the drive shafts into the axle. Our bolt pattern is the same because ours is a 2009. They had the same transfer case whether it was a manual or an automatic, so I wasn't too worried about that. This one came out of a 2009 as well. It has the same spline counts, same bolt pattern. All we got to do is bolt this in. Now I am going to have to change the yokes out because they had changed this out. They must have put a heavier duty front drive shaft in, an aftermarket drive shaft. So I got to pull that out and put this one in because we're still running stock drive shafts, but that'll be something for the future.
Really, if we're going to four wheel this thing, that's something I should do anyway. One of the things I've done in all my rigs, minus like this eBay JK so far, is stepped up to Adams drive shafts. I've used them for everything. You know, you can get the rock crawler setups where they're heavy duty, long spline. You know, you can go as big as you want, as small as you want. You know, I got them in my Samurais with Toyota drive shafts, all the way up to like my S10 with 1350 joints and things like that. They do 1410, and I have a discount code with them. So if you are going to get a drive shaft and you want a discount, you can use the code COLT10 and get 10% off of all your drive shafts. So that is something we'll definitely do for the future. I'm going to save that yoke for the future when we actually plan on doing drive shafts. I just don't know if I'm going to keep this size lift or eventually if we're going to step this thing up into that next level as we go down the road. Right now though, going from that to that is great. And you can see the size difference up here for that 4:1 case because it's a little bit bigger. So you can see how much smaller this is and how much bigger it is. And I don't even know if the case is itself is bigger, but this is, it just adds more girth. They do that too, to add more girth and more strength to the case won't break. So I changed the yokes out to the 4:1 T case. Now Ian can go ahead and reinstall it.
And we can save this one. Nice little backup case.
Maybe one day I'll figure out how to make a doubler 241J. Double those up.
Bring her to me.
Are you ready?
It's just like this when it goes in. Yeah, there it is.
Got it?
Yep.
Ow! My balls!
I think somebody just pinched their manhood.
We got this one was a little bit bigger.
Not light, that's for sure.
I'm a man.
Okay. See?
Oh.
Now you can put some bolts in.
4, 2, 1, power.
All right, so pulling the T-case out is the exact reverse steps going back in. Now, one thing you want to make sure is that you really do get your 6 bolts in here snug, very, very snug. That's probably the number one failure I've ever seen in aluminum T-cases is the bolts get loose, the nuts get loose and the studs, and then the T-case can twist and wiggle, and then it breaks. Between that and no fluid. So those are the two things we got to make sure we do. Also, when you put these drive shafts in, I'm usually a big proponent of using Loctite because you have, you know, bolts that hold your U-joints in. A drive shaft like this, though, it has so many bolts. I am not going to put any Loctite on these. I'm just going to get them snugged up because I'm hoping that I can change them out later with better stuff. I'm not a big fan of these stock drive shafts anyway. We'll do that in a future video. I'll get some measurements for Adam's drive shaft. Also, if you guys ever get on the website, you can go on ColtBuildsIt.com. And in member discounts, I have tons of discounts. So if you guys are building a rig or whatever, you can get on there. And maybe that'll help you get a discount when you're buying parts for your stuff.
I just need to get the front on, skid plate, and then we're ready to rock. Just keep wrenching, just keep. I'm so bored. You know, he showed you guys hooking up that TV, but he didn't actually hook it up for me to watch anything yet. Sitting in here, wrenching away, past hour and a half, just wrenching. Fun times. Just keep wrenching, just keep wrenching. We'll get there. Slowly but surely. All right.
So Ian got the drive shaft bolts tight. We snugged them up. I had him hold the brakes and just got them a little snugged up. Now we got to check the fluid. Now, one of the things I like to say before you ever pull a drain plug on a transfer case especially is pull the fill plug to make sure that you can actually get the fill plug off, because I ran into that problem before and then that ended up being a bad news deal trying to make it work. And on this 4-to-1 T case, it is a 10 millimeter Allen. Now I got that loose, I know we're good. I can go ahead and get the plug off for the drain, which wasn't tight at all, which is good. But we'll go ahead and drain this out, and then we'll fill it back up until it starts pouring out. Then we know the T-case is full. Then we'll take it on test drive. And Ian's got to put that skid plate on still, but then we'll take it on test drive.
Red goo.
Well, that was neat.
What?
Oh, I just squirted all over my pants.
Oh, he peed himself.
So once this comes out the top, then I know the transfer case is full. I got to put a little more in, probably another quart. But one of the things that is kind of a rule of thumb for most transfer cases, if the transfer case is chain driven, meaning there's a chain that goes out to your front output, 90% of the time it's going to take transmission fluid. If your transfer case is gear driven, meaning it's gears that run across over to your front output, then 90% of the time it's going to take gear oil. If it's just gears, it should probably take gear oil. If it has a chain, then you want to put transmission fluid in it. I would say most of the time on all T cases, that's how it works. Little nugget of knowledge if you're ever unsure.
Last thing, just got to get the skid plate back on. Nothing ain't touching this one right here. All right, T-case hand. Ready to test drive.
Isn't she beautiful? New winch, new top. Of course, new transfer case. See how she runs.
All right, Ian and I are here at the Glade, and I am going to put this thing in four low and see how it does. Last time I was on this hill specifically, it was struggling pretty good. It was pulling, I mean, you could hear the transmission whining as it was pulling the hill. So we're gonna see how it does this time. And there's the hill. And I just wanna see how this thing pulls. I'm really kind of curious how easy it's gonna walk up the hill, if it's gonna struggle transmission wise or anything like that. And I can tell you right now, like, we're pulling this hill and this is no issue at all. This thing isn't even trying. Like, I'm barely giving it any throttle in first and it is walking right up. And that's steep. The awesome part about that too is you have the same thing going downhill now as well, because you got that lower gear ratio. It's actually gonna help with the downhill drive and you won't be pulling as hard. You won't have to ride your brakes as hard going downhill. Let the gears do the work. Well, I can tell you right now, this thing has way more torque, way more low range. That was full tire pressure and it just, I mean, it was just wanting to spin tires because it's just got all the torque that you could need in low range now. So this thing's working really good. I'm really happy with it. You did good.
Thank you.
Maybe I should have aired down.
One of the other things I can tell you that was a good move was getting this lighter colored tan, you know, sandy brown top. It is way cooler in this thing. I've been out here, 95 degrees out right now. We don't have the AC on, we just got the windows down, and it is way cooler in this thing than it gets hot boxed normally with that dark black top. So having this lighter top made a big difference. These Rubicon transfer cases I have seen as cheap as $800 and as much as $2,000. So, you know, that's a big variation in the price count. It just kind of depends on where it's at and what version of the Jeep it'll fit. But what I can tell you with this is that for the bang for buck, I mean, it was the cost of what you would consider basically a locker without install. I'd say that we got a heck of a deal to get lower gears on what you could put in an afternoon, as long as you got the tools to do it. You think it was worth it?
Definitely worth it.
Ian's growing a sweet vote for Pedro stash.
Give me 8 months, all right?
8 months? 8 months to grow the mustache?
We'll get it nice and thick, you know?
Like Tom Selleck.
I'm thinking more Sam Elliott.
Sam Elliott.
I'm headed to the ocean.
Hey, the fact that you know who Sam Elliott is makes me feel like I'm winning as a dad. All right, well, we appreciate you guys watching. Hope to see you next time. Please make sure you like and subscribe. Bye-bye. Shift linkage ever is missing its centerpiece, you can actually get a bushing kit for a GM like this and put it in.